Today, we're talking albums that you as a drummer should own. The band is Rush. The album?
Moving Pictures.
What is happening, everybody? Welcome to my channel. My name is Jeff. If this is your first time here, click the little subscribe thingamabobber, hit the bell notifications, leave a like, leave a nasty comment down in the comment section below. Tell me about what album you think I should talk about here for drummers to listen to. If you got an album for a drummer and you think, hey man, if you're a drummer, you need to hear this album, put it in below. Maybe I'll go out, if I don't have it, maybe I'll go out and buy it and maybe I'll talk about it a little bit. So this is a new show for me. I've kind of been, like a lot of YouTubers, I get to a certain point, like a midlife crisis, I guess. I've been doing this a couple of years and my subscriber base has grown, but it's grown slowly. And the reason it's grown slowly is because, number one, stuff I put out is not very good. And number two, the stuff I put out is actually drum covers. Here's the thing with drum covers. This has mostly been a drum cover show. Or channel, I'm sorry. While I really enjoy making drum covers, I enjoy the process. To me, it's like putting together a model. But once it's done, I'm kind of like, what do I do with this, you know? It's not really adding anything of value to the world, I guess is what I'm saying. But watching some fat middle-aged dude play drums, let's face it, man, there's not a big market for that. And I know that. I'm well aware of that. I just do it because I enjoy doing it. But I'm kind of like looking for something more, something where I can start giving back a little bit. Because I've played in a lot of bands over the years. I have a lot of just knowledge of just, I know how to gig and I know my way around a song. Yeah, I know how to come up with drum parts for songs. And I think maybe it's time for me to start sharing some of that knowledge, I guess. So that's the whole point of this show, is to take albums I've heard through the years and talk about them a little. So this seems like a really obvious choice. Rush for me is, I guess I was a little late to the Rush parade as far as drummers go. I had already been playing a few years before I really started getting into Rush. How I discovered them, I mean, I was aware of them and I've heard them. And this is the one thing I'm going to talk about a lot in this show, is there's a big difference between hearing music and listening to music. Hearing and listening are two different things. You put music on your MP3 player and you go out and you do a bunch of other crap while you got music going. You're hearing the music. You're not listening to music. In the age of the digital age, we've lost a lot of that. We don't listen to music anymore. We hear music. And that's why I love physical media. That's why I love CDs. That's why I love vinyl records, even tapes, especially vinyl and tapes, because there's nothing easy about playing that kind of media. I mean, you can't skip from song to song to song. You have to listen. I think that's been lost. How I discovered Rush is I was about 14, 15 years old, something like that. I was, you know, like my freshman year of high school. And I had a kid that sat next to me, and he was a keyboard player. Allegedly, this dude had, like, played in bands. He's telling me this whole big, long story about all these gigs he's done and stuff. He was probably full of shit. But I didn't know that at the time, you know? And he's telling me how he's played all these bands and everything. And he's like, you went to Rush. And I'm like, I didn't want to think, like, I was uncool. I'm like, yeah. And it's funny because now I could care less if anybody that was a keyboard player thought I was uncool. No offense to you keyboard players out there, but you know, this guy had he wore a keyboard scarf. Yeah. So I was worried about what that guy thought about me. I know Rush, you know? And he's like, cool, man, let's jam sometime. Let's do Tom Sawyer. I'm like, great. I guess I gotta go get some Tom Sawyer. I guess I gotta listen to it. And I was aware of the song, you know. Once again, I had heard, I hadn't listened to it. I can't remember how I got a hold of the tape. I begged, borrowed, stealed, or whatever. I got a copy of Moving Pictures. For the first time in my life, instead of hearing Rush, I listened to Rush. And I listened to Tom Sawyer. And I knew I was in trouble. Listening, even at that age, I was at that point, I was an okay drummer. You know, I could kind of do some stuff. And I'm like, there was some stuff happening in this song that I wasn't aware you could do, I guess. The way he constructed his parts and the cerebral nature of it, you know, even as a young kid, I was picking up on that. At 14, 15 years old, I was picking on, like, this dude is something different. As a guy who I loved at that time was John Bonham. He was pure feel. John Bonham was pure feel. And that's more my style, actually. I feel the music. Whereas a guy like Neil, he constructed his parts very precisely to fit within each section of the song. Quick history on Rush, and why this is interesting is because the album Moving Pictures almost really didn't get made. And that was like, I think that was like their creative peak as a band. Signals, Moving Pictures, and Permanent Waves. Those three albums. And I think probably Moving Pictures was the peak of those three albums. But if you go back to their early history, because Rush was formed in the early 70s, and they were more of a straight ahead, like kind of Led Zeppelin-y type rock band. John Rutsey was on drums at the time. I'm sure a lot of you are aware of that. And after they toured the first album, I don't know if they dismissed Rutsey or he left the band. I know he had some health problems. I think he had diabetes and stuff. So he was no longer part of the band. And they got Neil Peart. And that's when things started to change for them. Because now they got this cerebral guy who, let's face it, he was kind of nerdy. He was kind of awkward, but he was super smart. He approached things in a different manner. And it's so foreign to me. And that's why I think it was such a good thing for me to embrace as a young kid, is the fact that it was so foreign to me, that was here was this guy who just didn't everything like by the seat of his pants. He thought about shit, and he really put time in these drum parts. They tour Fly By Night. Fly By Night does well. You know, it does fairly well. And then they come out with their third album, Caress of Steel. This album did not do well. And a lot of like hardcore Rush fans really like this album. I don't get it. I tried listening to it. It's too much for me. It's just, I don't get it. You know, Bastille Day is a cool song. Lakeside Park's okay. But some of the other stuff, like the Fountain of Men, wow, what the hell's going on there, man? I really don't. So that album does not do well because it's just weird. Too weird, even for Rush fans, a lot of Rush fans. So at this point, Rush is, they're kind of in trouble with their record label. The record label is putting pressure on them. You guys got to get more commercial. You got to write more commercially viable music. And what does Rush do? And this is the best thing about Rush is, and it's so ironic that the punk rockers hate them, because this is one of the most punk rock things to do. So here they are under pressure from their record label to put out more commercially viable music. And what do? The album Side A is a 20-minute and some second song. And that is just not the ultimate. This is what we do. We don't care what you think. This is how we're going to do it. And if we're going to go down, we're going to go down in our terms. And that album resonated with people. And the reason it resonated with people is pretty simple. It's, we've all been in a situation where somebody's trying to hold us down. Somebody's pushing against us, keeping us from moving forward. And that album is about that. About the system coming down on you and somebody finally fighting back and saying, no, enough. This is not right. This is not the right way to do things. You can't control me anymore. And that really resonates with people. I mean, and that's actually a very, very punk rock attitude. Anyways, that led to just a build. You know, they put out some really good albums in the 70s. In the 80s is when they changed their sound a little bit. They got away from the big concept albums and the big concept songs. Their music was no less amazing and intricate. Like I said, Permanent Waves is a great album, but I really think they peaked with Moving Pictures. And first up is the song that kind of did it for me. The one I really, the first time I listened to. I mean, this is the first Rush I actually really listened to. I knew the song. I was aware of the song. Once again, I hadn't listened to the song. And when I listened to the song, I was completely blown away. Starting off. What a killer way to start a song, right? It's just, it's an explosion. Boom. But that one note with that long synthesizer just ringing out and decaying. And you go underneath, and what's Neil doing? He's holding it all together. He's creating glue. And he's not creating glue with necessarily a busy bass drum part or a busy snare drums part. And he's filling the space. But he's subtly filling the space. And what he's subtly filling that space with is those 16th notes on the hi-hat. Really tight. What I love right there, when you come out of that first line, today's Tom Sawyer, blah, 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 he does it's a four measure phrase before Geddy starts singing again. Or it's four bars. And what Neil does in those four bars is he slowly builds it. First time through, he's got one kick. Second time through, two kicks. Third time through, three kicks. Fourth time through, four kicks. And what he's doing is he's building up to something. I never would have thought of that. I mean, that's why he's him and I'm me. So let's check that out. It's Tom Sawyer, mean pride. One kick. Two kicks. Come right here. Three kicks. Next, we start building into the chorus. And what does he do? Once again, there's space to fill, but he's filling it with very subtle things. And I think the hi-hat maybe starts... Still playing that same pattern with the building bass drum. So now, leading in the chorus... He's getting more busy with his bass drum and his snare drum. But because it's a bigger part of the song and it swells up, he's off that hi-hat and he's over on the ride cymbal. And what that ride cymbal does is it creates wash, okay? He's accentuating the more open guitar chord playing that Alex Lifeson's doing. Okay, we're back to the hi-hat. Really tight. That right there is a great fill. It's so simple. So great, though. Once again, filling that up, it's open space, but it's a bigger part of the song. So instead of playing tight hi-hats with 16th notes, he just plays 8th notes, but he opens up that hi-hat to support it underneath. And it creates, once again, it's a swell, but it's a less obvious one, I guess you would say. Maybe as the skies. Back to the tight hi-hat. That's killer right there. So now we're going to the 7 part. This is great. Before we get into the 7 part, let me say something that Rush had an ability to play odd time signatures and go into odd time signatures without the listener knowing it was an odd time signature. Somehow it feels like it's in 4. And it's the looping pattern of his drum parts. I don't know. It's great. I love this film. Once again, we're staying in 7 all the way through the guitar solo. And clinic on... It's a clinic on building. Because he's right here. He's constantly throwing odd snares in and building the intensity throughout the solo. We're leading to something. And what we're leading to is this. Here we go. Just blown away, man. 15 years old. Really listened to that for the very first time. Just absolutely freaking blown away by what I was hearing. I became obsessed with learning these drum parts. So great. I want to get into YYZ real quick. And I sit here, I could go through every song on this album. I would be on here for 3 hours. So YYZ is the airport code for Toronto. Allegedly, this is Morse code for YYZ. I don't know. Maybe it's true. It's a cool story if it's not, but let's get into it. Mm-hmm. Listen to this. He changes the pattern. So he starts throwing a kick drum in between. Oh, bop, 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 bop. It's great, man. So here's what's interesting about this. Now, before with Tom Sawyer, okay, it's more spatial. So what's he doing with his hi-hat? He's filling the space with a tight 16th note hi-hat. Now, with this song, the bass and the guitar are playing a pretty aggressive melody. And they're kind of, that it falls on them. So whereas the other song with the verses, there's more space with the guitars and the bass are playing. This song, they're playing something much more syncopated and a lot busier. So what does Neil do? There's no need to fill that space anymore. Because all the space is there's no space to fill. So rather than try to play over the top of that or get in the way of that, he plays quarter notes over the top. Open hi-hat. Sloshy hi-hat. And the bass drum and the snare are accentuating, but they're not overly busy and clashing with what Alex and Getty are doing. Now we get to, I guess, what is the chorus? I guess you would call it the chorus of the song. It's the melody. Neil changes it up again. The guitar and bass are not as busy, okay? We went from that really, that hard do-do-do-do-do-do to a more open, melodic type thing. So Neil's, once again, he's filling the space, but he's filling it subtly on the bell of the ride cymbal with a very nice syncopated ride pattern. Fantastic, man. Fantastic. Okay, so now Alex is down, 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 down. What's Neil do? He goes over in the hi-hat, starts playing an eighth note, like coming up on the upbeats with his foot. Creates, filling that. Kind of like a disco thing. And here's what I love about this is you got a Getty break, you got a Neil break. You got a Getty break, you got a Neil break. And what Neil does kind of accentuates what Getty did the one before that. Not so much this one. Sorry. Not so much this one, but the last one. I mean, this one a little bit. The hi-hats. This one's great. Neil really kind of gets the same vibe on this one right here. Once again, over on the bell of the ride cymbal. So I love this fill coming out of the guitar solo. I saw Rush live about 16 times. I would say at least half of those times I saw Rush when they would do this song. Neil would do that fill and he would throw his drumstick up. Neil used to say, I like to throw my drumsticks high because it adds an air of excitement to everything because you're not exactly sure where they come down. And man, when he throw them high, I mean, he throw them up like almost as high as the lighting truss. I mean, that's probably 20 feet up in the air. And just a cool little story. Okay, open part. Subtly filling that space. That's cool how he comes in on the four on a cymbal rather than coming my, what I would do, what Jeff would do would be snare, crack. Neil doesn't do that. Now, Neil thinks about things. Jeff doesn't. Neil comes in with a cymbal. Shoot. And he chokes it. It's really cool, man. All right, let's get to the end. That's a cool little thing right there, too, man. Moving Pictures. If you don't already have it, go buy it. See you guys next time.